Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Locandy. With 6 weeks left to go in the legislative session, Senator John DeFrancisco joins us to tell us what's going on.
It's been done in a blind fashion in the past, and it was like pulling teeth trying to get more information.
Senator, for years now, you've tried to restore oversight to the comptroller for certain state contracts by SUNY, CUNY, and OGS. The Senate took up your bill again this year.
Well, you know, it's amazing that a lot of people complain that the economic development programs aren't working, the fact that the governor's got too much control, and you wonder why there's all these criminal trials going on. Convictions and more criminal trials to go forward on the economic development program, right. and how it was pay to play and the like. But you got to have a remedy. You can't just complain it's not a good thing. And I've been pushing for a couple of things. Number one is to have more transparency, and the way you do that is have someone looking over the projects before they're approved. Now, technically, right now we have the Public Authority Control Board, the PACB. With a member of the Senate, the Assembly, and the Governor's Office that give final approval of most of these proposals that go through economic development. But what's happened in the past is that the Economic Development Office doesn't provide any information to the board, and they rubber stamp it like this, okay? And the second thing is the comptroller used to have oversight over many of the economic development programs, and the governor convinced the legislature, quite frankly, I was part of it, convinced the legislature several years ago that when he first got in office or shortly thereafter, okay, that, you know, these programs, we need more speed. We can't just wait for all these approvals. And we foolishly, quite frankly, agreed with him and took off some of the oversight. So I think 3 years ago, the comptroller put up a bill, and I sponsored it immediately, seeing what a horrible mistake it was. Mm-hmm. And so those two bills were on the agenda this past week, and both of them passed. And I think they're good bills that provide some type of transparency.
Right. The governor's top aide was found guilty in a corruption trial, federal corruption trial, and the former head of SUNY Polytechnic and some upstate developers are going to be on trial shortly.
Correct. And
just an example.
Right. And when Prococo was convicted, the governor's chief aide, it was clear that there was inside dealing and preference given to the developers, and that's just wrong. And as far as the oversight by the Public Authority Control Board, when I found how bad it was recently, it was when that building that was built, a factory was built by SUNY Polytech. The state built a building for a company to come in to do LED lighting manufacturing. And they never went into the building. We spent $90 million of taxpayers' money, and they never went in the building. So what got me going was the governor came up with another proposal to give $15 million to another organization. And the other organization was headed by an individual who had a previous company who had a proposal in Rochester, but the proposal never went anywhere with the Economic Development Office because that company went bankrupt. And I get the same CEO getting $15 million to enter that program, to enter that building. So obviously we want to have that building productive, but shouldn't you look into the financial background, look into things about this company this company that's headed by a CEO who put one company into bankruptcy already? Mm-hmm. So finally, I just held it up. The Senate held that proposal up, held it up until the disclosure was given, and until it was shown specifically what penalties they would have to experience if they did not perform. Unlike the first project, where a company was built, a $90 million factory, and they walked away with impunity, without any kind of, yeah. So these types of proposals are absolutely necessary. The legislature has to assume its responsibility and provide for oversight of the governor's office. And those two bills were great. One thing I just want to add quickly, and that is I was asked by one media person, well, isn't that hypocritical? Now that the Senate is losing its majority, or the majority is so thin, now all of it, and the independent group went over to the Democrats, isn't it hypocritical that you would do it now? And I said, I've been trying to do it for 3 years, yeah. Number one. And number two, I don't think it's hypocritical. I think it was bad judgment by those deciding who, what bills get on the calendar. My judgment would have been different. That's not hypocritical, mm-hmm. but it was well needed. Now the point is that the Assembly's got to pass both of those bills, period. And hopefully the comptroller's working hard, lobbying the Assembly, and hopefully they'll do it.
All right. So the Senate passed a bill to help better protect the number of certified minority and women-owned business enterprises in each region of the state. So here's your explanation on that.
Okay.
For people upstate, when there aren't enough minority and women-owned businesses, primarily because we can't get anybody certified with the incompetence of the administration in that department, what happens is I have people in my district that have to go outside my district and mostly closer to New York City to find the minority and women businesses that have been certified. And I have a responsibility to people in my district because we would like to have them make some money. We would have to like to have economic vitality in upstate New York as well. And that's wrong. That's simply wrong. So all this bill is doing is if there is a problem, whether it's the governor's office and certifications or what, or whether it's simply because there aren't enough to find in these categories, there should be a regional determination, not some broad statewide determination of what the numbers should be, but a regional one, because maybe you don't know it, but certain regions of the state are economically deprived. Other regions of the state are just doing great economically. And those of us who are in those districts that are struggling would love to be in a position to get businesses and contractors working, making money, and creating jobs.
So how will updating the state contract requirements change things?
Well, what's changing now, I've had so many individuals, contractors in all fields that saying that we've got this requirement of 30% minority or women business-owned entities, and they can't find them. They can't find them, especially minority businesses. So they have to go out of the district, try to find some, pay additional funds to bring people from out of the area. And, you know, there's two problems here. Number one, if you want a 30% requirement, don't hold up the certifications for a year, 2 years, trying to get certified. Mm-hmm. Don't hold them up. Get them moving. You could put some resources that may be going to Puerto Rico to do business down there and help the Puerto Rican community. Why don't you send them to Syracuse, New York? Send them to the department that's determining minority businesses. Use the money where it is important for the whole state. And until that is done, you can't require businesses in certain regions to go out of their region, cost more money, and the jobs for our region are not impacted positively at all.
Yeah, so there was a package of bills to protect taxpayer money and make sure it's invested properly. You can find them on your website, defrancisco.nysenate.gov. So last week, we talked about a bill that you had that would manage the deer population. It was specific to different parts of the region. And a similar thing happened when a senator from the Adirondacks got pushback from her bill to allow kids under the age of 18 to participate in organized competitive snowmobiling racing events. So here's your response to that.
If you haven't lived in the snow country very long, you don't realize that This snowmobiling is a huge activity for the people in those areas. And rather than having the nanny state determine what should be done at these events that are well supervised and with the parents' consent, we'd rather have the actual nanny, the mother and the father, make these decisions rather than the state of New York, which seems to want to make every decision about someone's life. And so I believe that parents' point of view is very important, especially in an activity that is an activity that promotes family life and inclusion of children in family activities.
Isn't that what we want?
I think so, but people from the city seem to think that the state should dictate everything, not necessarily from the city, but those who are so-called progressive thinkers. I think it's not an apt name for that part of the party, of the Democrat Party, but the fact of the matter is it's family activities are important. The parents are supervising the parents. This was basically races, small area races where young people could be involved in races by the children. I mean, if the parents are supervising and they want it to be done, I think they have a little bit better judgment on their children than the state of New York does.
Right, I agree. So back in your district last week, hundreds of senior citizens, including yourself, attended the Onondaga County Luncheon and Awards Ceremony. Tell us about it.
Well, it was great. Every year the department in Onondaga County honors a few seniors for activities that they've done that were important to show that they're still, the most important thing, not only that they did something wonderfully, but the most important thing is that it's showing other seniors that you can remain active. You don't just fade away, and you don't just, by vegetating, you're going to fade away. You got to keep active, and here's some examples of active seniors that are doing great things. And there must have been 500 people at the luncheon, and it was well done, and people were honored, and they got the message.
This is Dorothy Dottie White, whose decades of volunteer work earned her the title of Senior Citizen of the Year. Other recipients, Marianne Barth got the Flanders Memorial Caregiver of the Year Award, and the Serving Seniors Honorees of the Year were Brian Evans Sr. and Mariette Chance Pollard.
Yes, all very active, all very interesting people. The most interesting one was Mrs. Pollard. Now, I knew her husband. I know he was a dean at Syracuse University, and I didn't know them very well at all. But she works at the Dunbar Center, a facility in the inner city that does great things for the kids, provides activities. And she's talking about her life a little bit, very little bit, but in it, she indicated that she's going to be 72 in October. And she says, and we've been married 49 years. Well, I thought she was talking about me. So after she got done speaking, I was still on the stage. I went up to her, when is your birthday? And she will be 72 a week after I am. And their anniversary is about 5 or 6 months after our anniversary this year. So we kind of hit it off pretty well. It was fun. I went over and talked to her husband and asked him what the secret was. And he kind of wasn't sure. I said, I know what the secret was. You just say yes. And then it saves a lot of time and energy, and you get along really well. But he laughed about it. But ironically, the next night, my wife and I went out to dinner at a restaurant near our home, and who was there but the Pollards? I couldn't believe it. So it's these activities are wonderful activities, and she gave and the others gave a great message. Stay active and stay young.
Mm-hmm. So one of the most beneficial things that you do, and people hear all over, is your senior fair, your senior resource fair, and that is our look back today.
Let's take a look.
We had a great turnout. It's usually around 1,000 people, and it was at least that this year.
It gives you an idea of what's available. I don't think a lot of people realize everything's available. So when you come to something like this, you see all these different agencies that are willing to help and can help.
So they could get information on just about anything under one roof at one time, rather than going to a state building for this, a county building for that, a city building for that, or private industry who provides services for seniors as well. So as a practical matter, it's well received and people keep coming back.
The whole fair is nice because you see people from one year to another.
Nice seeing you. Thanks for this. It's really informative.
Most of the people, quite frankly, were thanking me for doing this and making sure that we continue to do it because it's so valuable to them. Other people had some complaints about state government or issues that were going on.
But there's so much waste of money in the public school systems. It's terrible. It's an outrage.
And I either was able to get the information directly from them, or we had a constituent service table so my staff members could get the information, start doing the research, and we could try to look into their specific problem and see if we could help.
I had signed up for energy for my house, and they told me that it would be at least 3 years before I'd be on the top of the list, and I said, I'm 89, I can't wait 3 years. So I talked to one of the ladies from there, and she called, and she said, they put me up, and they'll call me tomorrow.
I think it's a great program. I also learned about the new incomes for EPIC and, you know, changes that have been made over the years.
People who have huge prescription drug bills, the EPIC program from New York State, they were here to give people information and to sign people up.
It was great. We come every year. John DeFrancisco is our senator, and we love him.
So she says that she gets a picture with you every year.
Every
year. And she
year,
has them all
every
like, lined
year,
up.
Every year. My wife is, people are starting to talk that I've got so many pictures with this lady. She's a beautiful lady, and there's a perfect example. She gets out and about. She's 89 years old. She's still active. She's still interested in the issues, and she's still looking for more information. I mean, that's why she's 89.
Mm-hmm. Well, now she's...
No, now she's probably 90 something. But it's great. It's a wonderful event, and it's well appreciated, and I appreciate that they enjoy it.
Thank you so much for being with us today, Senator. And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For additional information, defrancisco.mysenate.gov.